What every Adventist scientist should know, carbon-14 dating. We're going through a series that talks about what every Adventist scientist should know. The reasons for that being that they are theologically significant areas of science, and they are areas, at least some of them, and this one is one of them, where Adventists have played a significant role. We talked about the philosophy of science last week. There's a whole section on is there a God, the origin of the universe, the privileged planet, the origin of life, the task of unguided evolution, and genetic entropy. How old is life on Earth? And the subsidiary question, which is the same, was there a universal flood? And we should know about widespread layers and turbidites, rates of erosion, paraconformities and soft sediment deformation, paleocurrents, carbon-14 dating, which is our subject for today, uranium-lead dating, and erosional features, and in particular, the implications of the Bretz floods, and now we're discovering floods all over, where they have been missed by standard geology because of its prejudices. I think we should also look at challenges to young life creationism, Coconino sandstone, the Yellowstone fossil forest, which are historical challenges, and the ones which are brought up the most commonly now, namely ice cores and radiometric dating. And finally, I think we should involve ourselves with Ellen White's health messages, because those are areas where science and theology interact. First, the general overview of her health messages, and then specifically looking at her comments about alcohol and what the present day evidence is. Now, on carbon-14 dating, I should perhaps review, because some of you are not as familiar as you might be with what's been going on. A brief history of carbon-14 and fossil carbon. We're going to talk about the missing presentation. We're going to talk about the critics. And they're perhaps the most revealing, because they're the people who have no interest in making this thing work. Yet they will testify against various ways of explaining the data away. And we will come to an interim conclusion. I'm reminded that as an emergency physician, we don't usually give diagnoses, we give impressions. And that's because when we send a patient home or send a patient in, we may not have an absolutely firm diagnosis. And then finally, of course, we're going to welcome your comments. Carbon-14 dating, just the very briefest of explanations, and it won't have all of the nuances that there are. Perhaps I'll point out a little bit, but this is kind of the bare bones of it. Carbon-14 is formed at the atmosphere, in the atmosphere. Right now it's assumed to be at a constant rate. It is converted to carbon-14 dioxide, which mixes with ordinary carbon dioxide in the biosphere. And the first assumption was, and it is still felt to be a fairly good assumption, although it's recognize that it's not an absolute one, but it's one with which many creationists would disagree, that in the biosphere, that is the atmosphere, the plants and animals, carbon that can be exchanged with those, carbon dioxide mixes to form a relatively constant ratio of carbon-14 to carbon-12. While plants and animals are eating and bringing in carbon, they're bringing in carbon with this relatively constant ratio of carbon 14 to ordinary carbon. But when plants or animals die, or plants lay down wood, they no longer exchange the carbon 14 with the biosphere. And so now we have carbon 14 no longer being replenished. And so it decays, and its decay is now unopposed by being replenished. And so the decay is exponential. And so theoretically, if you know the carbon 14 to ordinary carbon ratio, you can predict the age. That's the essence of the standard model of carbon 14 dating. Now, there have been a few people, and I need to put two more in here eventually, namely Robert Brown and Robert Gentry, who have both published estimates as to how much carbon 14 should be still in the biosphere from before the flood, and therefore from any material before the flood, which if you assume that the flood started in the Cambrian, that means anything in the Phanerozoic, that is to say anything that has a significant animal and plant fossils. And during its early phases, the Creation Research Society Quarterly mostly paid attention to the imbalance of carbon-14 production and decay, but there was one paper that argued that we should date amber by carbon-14, saying that we would probably find some carbon-14 in the amber, and that would make it impossible to date the amber at millions of years old. There's the reference there. Andrew Snelling made multiple measurements. In 1997, he published a paper called Radioactive Dating in Conflict, Fossil Wood and Ancient Lava Flow Yields Radiocarbon. And if you were listening very carefully to the Ham-Nye debate, that particular datum came up. It's the one thing that that Ken Ham said about carbon-14 dating. And Bill Nye didn't have an answer to it, but of course it's one datum, and one can say, well, the laboratory was bad that day or had a problem with that date. It was published twice, once in 1997 and then again in 2001 in a different venues, with the CEN Technical Journal having a lot more space as to be able to say what the geology of the formation was in which they did the dating. And one of them could only say it was older than so much or had less than so much carbon-14 in it. And that could be an infinite date, which would fit with the standard model. Another part of it gave 29,500, essentially 30,000 years, and here's one that was 38,000 years, or 2.53% modern carbon, and this one is 0.90% modern carbon. Remember, the predicted value for these things is all zero by the standard model. Andrew Snelling continued to date some more specimens. In 1998, he got one that was, one of them was 33,000, the other one was greater than 48,000. Again, this matches the standard model. This one, of course, does not. Although you can see that the standard deviation is somewhat wide, and if one were skeptical, one could say that, I think I'd have to look that up. I think this may be the two standard deviations here, in which case it is stretching it a bit to say that it's that too old. In 1999, he published another one with the same kind of thing, only this time it was accurate enough that it's pretty much beyond question that his dates are, in fact, finite and not infinite. Then in 2000, he published a fourth one. And here you can see there's a number of them, and they're all in the range of, about 2.7 to 2.8 to 7.6% modern carbon. That's a lot of carbon in something that should have had, by standard mathematics, had all of its carbon 14 decay. At about this time, this 1997 is a little bit deceptive because they were about 3 years late in publishing this particular issue of Origins. They had been running later and later, and then they finally, so it was actually more like 2000 that this was published. I proposed that carbon 14 and fossil carbon should be studied carefully. Actually, I did it in a book called Scientific Theology that was published in 1997, but this one was in Origins. And then I did a review of the literature in Origins in 2001, which is probably the most comprehensive one out there. Then the RATE group got interested in that about 2001, 2002, and funded a study that was finally completed, mostly completed in 2003, but then they went on to study some diamonds, and the final report was in 2005 in the book Radioisotopes in the Age of the Earth, otherwise known as the RATE book. And it is now available for free on the web if you want to go to it. By the way, this will be on the internet, so if you want to scroll to the area and freeze frame, you can copy down the website. And in fact, in some of them, there will be actual references that you can just click to get to. The RATE group found quite a bit of carbon-14, but not as much as what Andrew Snelling had found. It was more in the, 0.5% to about 0.1819% as the lowest. And the interesting thing of this is that this is a whole bunch of coal, and that the highest and the second lowest are found in Pennsylvania, and the second highest and the lowest are found in Cretaceous. It doesn't seem to make much difference which geological era you're looking for. That there isn't, for example, a tendency for the oldest ones to be in the Pennsylvania, and then the youngest ones to be in the Eocene. The RATE group also dated some diamond, and this was reported in the RATE group's book, and you will notice that some of the diamonds were close to what their official background was and could conceivably be, these are two standard deviations, could conceivably be just in the background, whereas some of their diamonds were clearly outside. Now, diamonds are very difficult to burn, and it's possible that the procedure may have introduced some carbon-14, so I'm a little bit cautious about saying that this is the actual level of carbon-14 in diamonds. But diamonds are also Precambrian, which means that there shouldn't be any whatsoever in the diamonds. And at our first pass, it looks like there is. In 2004, Russell B. Rada published an article on carbon-14 coming from radium and concluded that in order to get the kinds of levels that we have in coal, the coal would have to consist of 99%+ uranium, which, in which case, one raises the question, why aren't we mining this for uranium instead of coal? John Doty published three articles in carbon-14 and natural gas, including CO2, and Unfortunately, he doesn't give standard deviation, so it's hard to say how much of this is statistical variation. But he had an average of 0.361% modern carbon corrected for background. And he did it again in 2006 when he measured the CO2 in the carbon 14 in CO2 and also the carbon 14 in methane. And you can see that we are getting detectable levels of carbon 14. Then the Paleo group published some data in Creation Research Society Quarterly. And there's the reference. And they were finding very small levels of carbon 14 in amber. That is to say, it was not statistically distinguishable from zero. The Paleo group then went on to publish a paper on carbon 14 in Singapore, or more precisely, to present a paper. I think you can get the paper itself on the internet, but it's not been published in a peer-reviewed journal. And that's an interesting story. You see, in the 2012 meeting of the American Geophysical Union and the Asia Oceania Geosciences Society, which was held in Singapore in the 11th through the 15th of August, the 13th was when it was actually published. You can find this on the internet. They have a program that if you go down to this BG02 and you click on it, it will enlarge and you will get several presentations, number one, number two, number three, number four, number six, number seven, and number eight. And of course, the instant question is, well, where's five? Let's look at four and six because we're going to see them tracing soil organic carbon, Dr. Jang Yin Kim. Carbon isotopic and organic biomarker evidence of other things, obviously. Selvaraj Kandasamy. So that's four and six. Now, if you go to all of the abstracts, this is supposed to be all of the abstracts that were published in session BG02, you'll notice the first one is listed here. I'm going to skip down to the third and the fourth and the sixth. And here's the fourth again, Tracing Soil Organic Carbon. That's the full title, of course. Jung Yoon Kim. And then when you get down to six, five is still missing. Well, maybe they didn't send an abstract again, carbon. Just going back to where we were before, so you can see there's definitely a number missing. Well, if you get to the presentations as they were before, you will find that Leo 2, this is 003, this is 004, now we have a 005 and a 006. And 006 is, again, Kandasamy, carbon isotopic and organic biomarker, tracing soil organic carbon, Cheng Yun Kim. So we have found the missing presentation. It is a comparison of delta 13 and PMC, that's percent modern carbon, carbon 14 dating, for 10 Cretaceous and Jurassic dinosaur bones from Texas to Alaska, USA, China, and Europe. So the presentation that disappeared had to do with carbon 14 dating of dinosaur bones. Now, it's kind of interesting, some of the people that put it out, Hugh Miller, Hugh Owen, Robert Bennett, Maciej Jirczyk, you may recognize him as one of the people that spoke in the movie Expelled, saying in Poland, we don't have the problems that you do in the United States with censorship. So he found out that in Singapore, the long arm of censorship reached out too. Incidentally, this is a Catholic group. They're arguing for short age. The Pope has said that evolution is okay with him, which means that these people are literally more Catholic than the Pope. Well, they did have an abstract, and here it is. And there's the title, and there's the people, and the abstract talks about 8 dinosaurs from Texas to Alaska and 1 from China. So they're getting these from all over. The accelerated mass spectrometer was used for 20 of the 22 samples, primarily at the University of Georgia. One of those sectarian Christian universities you may have heard of. Two large samples were tested on conventional equipment as another cross-check. So they did it not only with accelerator mass spectrometry, but in some of them they actually did it with the standard way of doing, the old-fashioned way of decay counting. And it matched what they got for the accelerator mass spectrometer. The delta 13 carbon range was minus 20 to minus 23.8. which is within the range that you'd expect for delta 13 carbon, which is says how much selection you have for isotopes in general. And the percent modern carbon ranged from 6.45 to 0.76, which translates to apparent ages of 22,000 for carbon in Acetocosaurus to 39,000 in a Triceratops from Montana. And they listed all of the different dinosaurs that they were looking at. For those of you who like math, here are some formulas. For those of you who don't, close your eyes. It'll be over in 30 seconds. The mean age is convenient because you can use it with natural log, which if you take your calculator and turn it sideways, if you have an iPhone, you can use the scientific calculator part of it and can actually do these calculations yourself. They go on to notice that previously there had been 2 grams of a Belgian mosasaur were pretreated to remove contaminants, and the percent modern carbon was 4.68. This one's actually in the peer-reviewed literature, and it's in PLOS One. And the mosasaur age was also concordant with percent modern carbons for their dinosaurs. Then they have some background information that will be interesting to some of you, but we'll kind of skip over it. The presentation itself, they actually showed up, they made the presentation, and we have proof because there's a YouTube out there. And this is a screenshot from the YouTube. Carbon-14 dated dinosaur bones under 40,000 years old. And here's some of the data that they had. As you can see, it's scattered from about 0.8% to 6.5% as the ones that they've got. Now, it's kind of interesting because these are the ones you just got through looking at. This is on a log scale now, which means that it goes from 0.1 to 1 is 1 unit, and 1 to 10 is 1 unit, and 10 to 100 is 1 unit. But the interesting thing of it is when you do that, you find out that they match what mammoths date usually. And for some reason, they have more carbon-14 than what you usually find from vegetation. And we've seen that actually in coal. Coal tends to be down in this range here in our other dates that we've been doing. Well, the presentation, as we noted, has disappeared from the website. And the American Geophysical Union has not commented on why. And the only thing that that we have that says why is from the Paleo group itself, who say, after the AOGS-AGU conference in Singapore, the abstract was removed from the conference website by two chairmen because they could not accept the findings. Unwilling to challenge the data openly, they erased the report from public view without a word to the authors or even to the AOGS officers until after an investigation. And they say it won't be restored, which, of course, if the investigation takes forever, that's one way of making sure it stays off of the AOGS-AGU website there. Now, that's the data that we have, and it kind of suggests that there is, in fact, carbon-14 in fossil carbon. What do the critics say? I'm going to take one of them that has kind of the standard criticism, which is the one that Herb Taylor has been saying he's going to publish for some time. I guess we'll see when that comes out. But this is the claim that it's all just contamination. And what they tried to do is to try to get rid of all of that coal data. And there's a website during which a discussion of this kind of thing took place. Franklin pointed out that in 1997, van der Borg dated some graphite, and he got 0.04% modern carbon, and that after processing the graphite, he got 0.18%. So the processing itself presumably added 0.14% modern carbon. That's pretty straightforward, I think. Arnold et al. In 1987 had graphite that was 0.089%, so a little more than van der Borg's, when they processed it and reported the results. It was 0.34% modern carbon, which means that the difference is 0.251, which means that processing could add as much as 0.25 and maybe, you know, in some cases a little more than that, at least in that particular laboratory. Baumgartner's values, he said, added to up to 0.27, and so 0.25 is just contamination. Well, in fact, Baumgartner's average 0.29 after you took out the contamination. He said 0.29, which easily could be contamination. It's actually 0.247, and with background added back in, it's 0.32, which is still above even the highest contamination we have here, and it's certainly much more than this contamination, and as a matter of fact, the laboratory this difference here, the background at their lab, the lab where it was actually done, was more like 0.7%. And that could be done by carbon-14 that started out as carbon dioxide. And in fact, there's a lab that does even better. It's Australian National University in Australia. And perhaps most important, there are two people who are actually carbon-14 researchers themselves and not simply analytical chemists like Franklin claims he is. I have no idea who Franklin really is. And Birchie thinks that the background, in fact, was real, and I'll just read the quote. While this conclusion, that is, contamination, explains the higher values for the biological samples in general, it does not account for all the details. Some biological samples do have radiocarbon levels not explained by sample chemistry. These samples are mostly coals and biological carbonates, both of which are prone to in situ contamination. So he's saying he's trying to blunt the force of that by throwing in that last clause. But he does admit that, in fact, that wasn't the laboratory that did all that stuff. Unlike the literature values, Baumgartner's coal samples do show significant radiocarbon above background, inviting explanation. So, yes, Baumgartner's coal samples are not just contamination. And this is Birchie, who got his PhD under Mueller, who started out with the idea of using he was using cyclotrons to try to date carbon-14, and was one of the two methods that was used that way. Accelerated mass spectrometers turns out to be much easier to use, and that's why it's being used now. And finally, Hunt, or her editors, who are keying off of Harry Gove's comments, think that the background is real. And again, accelerated mass spectrometry, a sensitive radiometric dating technique, is in some cases finding trace amounts of radioactive carbon-14 in coal deposits. Coal deposits. Amounts that seem to indicate of age of around 40,000 years. Though this result is still too old to fit into any young Earth creationist chronology, and we find out that that isn't true, it would also seem to represent a problem for the established geologic timescale, as conventional thought holds that coal deposits were largely, if not entirely, formed during the Carboniferous period, approximately 300 million years ago, and of course shouldn't have any radiocarbon. Since the half-life of carbon-14 is 5,730 years, any that was present in the coal at that time of formation should have long since decayed to stable daughter products. The presence of carbon-14 in coal, therefore, is an anomaly that requires explanation. So there you have it. It's really there. Now, Harry Gove, who's at Isotrace Laboratory, thinks that the background is real. So the physicists want to find fossil fuels that have very little carbon-14. In the course of this work, they've discovered that some fossil fuels vary widely in carbon-14 content. Some have no detectable carbon-14. Some have quite a lot. So apparently, at least some, actually most, because he was trying to use these for a detector where he wanted to have less than 1/1,000,000th of the amount of carbon-14 that you find in coal. And unfortunately, they weren't able to do that. So carbon contamination is not accepted as a good explanation for this carbon-14 by the critics who know the most about the procedures. Now, Kirk Birchie has his own explanation, and he says coal is notorious for contamination. Uranium is often found in or near coal, releasing neutrons that generate radiocarbon in the coal from nitrogen. Mobile humic acids are almost always present in coal and can transport more recent carbon to the coal. Microbial growth can incorporate modern carbon from groundwater while in situ and from air after sample collection. Coal can easily absorb atmospheric carbon-14, carbon dioxide after collection. So all these things can go wrong. And therefore, one of them must be the explanation. It can't be that it's really there, because that would mean it was too old. Notice that there are several explanations that he's throwing out. Carbon-14 contaminating the sample underground after being brought up, but before the laboratory gets hold of it. And also carbon-14 being made from neutrons. Notice also there's no attempt to make any kind of quantitative estimate as to how much is which one. To quote Birchie further, the expert who prepared and measured the rate samples suspects that the coal samples have been contaminated before reaching his laboratory, probably in situ. As mentioned earlier, coal is easily contaminated both in situ and after collection. Though precautions were taken, and they were, the coal samples may have also been contaminated while it's stored in the Department of Energy Geology Laboratory refrigerator. Geology laboratories often have elevated levels of radiocarbon due to tracer studies, neutron activation studies, and dust from uranium-bearing rocks. Carbon is highly mobile, and contamination can spread through an entire laboratory and persist for decades. Notice again, no numbers attached to that kind of thing. There is a reference that you can read. However, Kathleen Hunt, who is keying off of the work of Harry Gove, states, and this is talk origins again, this is not somebody who's trying to make an excuse for creationists at all. So the physicists want to find out fossil fuels that have very little carbon-14. In the course of this work, they've discovered that fossil fuels vary widely in carbon-14 content. Some have no detectable carbon-14, some have quite a lot. Apparently correlates best with the content of the natural radioactivity of the rocks surrounding the fossil fuels, particularly the neutron and alpha particle emitting isotopes of the uranium-thorium series. Again, notice no published data, no unpublished data that she's going to give, just it apparently correlates. Dr. Gove and his colleagues have told me that they think the evidence so far demonstrates that carbon-14 in coal and other fossil fuels is derived entirely from new production of carbon-14 by local radioactive decay of the uranium-thorium series. So Gove thinks that the stuff down there isn't getting contaminated by carbon-14 floating around and sticking on it, it getting contaminated in underground, it getting contaminated before it gets to the laboratory. He thinks, and he has probably more experience with this than anybody for several reasons, that they think that the entire derivation has to do with getting neutrons underground. Well, notice that they completely disregard the fungi bacteria hypothesis. That is, that carbon-14 in coal is produced by modern microorganisms currently living there. May also be plausible, but would probably only contribute to inflation of carbon-14 values if coal sits in warm, damp conditions exposed to ambient air. That is, if it's down a mile down in underground, it's not going to get any carbon-14 that way. There's also growing evidence that bacteria are widespread in deep rocks, but it is not clear that they could contribute to carbon-14 levels. They could contribute to carbon-13, but not carbon-14. So the only answer you have left is either it's real, in which case these are young, or this is made by neutrons underground. Well, Baumgartner, after a bunch of calculations that are based on literature, says we get the steady state value of 14 carbon, ordinary carbon, of 9 times 10 to the minus 6% modern carbon. This is more than 13,000 times smaller than the mean value of 0.12% modern carbon we measured for our first six diamonds samples, and is far below the AMS detection threshold. And of course, it's extremely far below the coal, and it's even further below the dinosaur bone data. Now, where are we now? I think it's arguable that carbon-14 is consistently measured in fossil carbon. I think machine error can be eliminated, in fact. Nuclear synthesis underground is orders of magnitude too small to account for the data, for those who actually do the calculations. Underground contamination is frankly unrealistic in most cases. I'm not saying it might not account for an occasional laboratory value, but it's not accounting for everything. Laboratory contamination is increasingly unrealistic. Again, not as it never happens or that it doesn't happen at a low level somewhere, but the measurements that we're taking are well above what laboratory contamination can account for. Comparison of fossil carbon and some other standard, I think, should be attempted because, unfortunately, it hasn't been done in a head-to-head comparison, and that really should be done, with both of them being processed exactly the same. But I think that in spite of all that, the most reasonable hypothesis is that, in fact, there is residual carbon-14 in fossil carbon, and therefore those fossils aren't as old as the standard model makes them out to be. Now, I don't expect this to get into the peer-reviewed literature for the same reason that the one presentation by the Paleo group disappeared. It's too controversial. There are four classes of creationist research. Those that make creationism harder to maintain, that's easy to publish. Those that are neutral, that's fairly easy to publish. Those that solve problems for creationism, that's a little harder to publish, but can be published, especially if you don't say too much in the conclusions. But those that strike at the heart of atheism, those that either show the need for an intelligent designer, or those that present a strong argument for short age, those are not going to be published unless they don't realize what they're publishing. Now, you don't have to be venal and cynical to oppose such research being published or to expect it to be opposed. One simply has to know that the opposition can't possibly be right, so there must be some flaw in the research, and that this research will be unfairly damaging if published. And besides, you know, they're creationists, they're lying for Jesus. Now, before we get too excited about that, keep in mind that every once in a while, some on our side do this kind of thing as well. So we need to be careful to temper our criticism of evolutionists who do it. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. I'll just put this over here and you guys can pass it around. Go ahead.
Comment regarding the thanks for the presentation, the update. The question, of course, tends to immediately come up. Well, these dates you're getting about, you know, 30,000 to 50,000 years. They don't fit with creation that was 6,000 years ago at all. And of course, people wonder why. And I'm just making this comment for those who may not follow that the model that Bob Brown has proposed and others is that before the flood, the level of carbon-14 was quite a bit lower than it is now, and that's why you get older dates, the less carbon-14 you have, the older your dates, your sample dates, of course. The only other comment I'd make is that since this is so pervasive, it's true they get a variation in the dates, you know, from 25,000 to 80,000. The fact that they've hardly found any sample that doesn't have any carbon-14 in it is interesting, and this may be the variability is probably comparable to variability we find now. You know, I can go and pick up some snails in Nevada, date them by carbon-14, they date at 27,000 years because they're growing in a limestone lake that has very little carbon-14 in it, and so they date old. And if you're going to postulate there's a variety that we have to get in here, I think you have to think in terms of maybe carbon-14 wasn't evenly distributed over the Earth before the flood.
That's an important point. And one of the things to keep in mind is that the climate today is not the same as the climate before the flood, if we read the record.
The Bible suggests there was no rain before the flood.
It suggests there was no rain to start out with. That's one. That means no rainstorms. No cold fronts mixing things in, no hurricanes. And we actually have something that's kind of interesting, and that is that in addition to producing carbon-14, we're producing chlorine-36 in the atmosphere. But that, instead of forming carbon dioxide and mixing with everything else, just drops straight down, pretty much. And chlorine-36 happens to be produced mostly in the middle to high latitudes, very little of it around the equator. And so in chlorine-36, we have an excellent model as to what would happen with production if we didn't mix. And so if you don't have mixing, then you do expect carbon-14 to concentrate around the poles of the ancient biosphere and to be less common in the equator. It would be very interesting for a creationist to try to go through some of these dates and try to figure out whether you can make sense about the latitude at which, in an ancient Earth, which had a presumably one continent at one time, whether you could get latitudes of carbon-14 production. It would be very interesting to see what would happen with that. That's a research project that's open to anybody who really wants to do it. Of course, getting it published might be an interesting problem. Go ahead and pass the mic up. Over now. Yes.
Thank you for a very exhaustive trip through the literature. I had never actually seen the plus or minus two standard deviations plotted on these points before. And one of the things that struck me as you were going through was the realization, which hadn't occurred to me before, that you're running up against something that happens to us all the time in the clinical laboratory, and that is you can't go below zero. And therefore, your data, as it approaches zero, for any measurement, is always going to be higher than it should be. Because you eliminate all the ones that would have gone the other side of zero, because that's impossible. So has anyone ever actually done a correction for the fact that you're getting down very close to zero, and therefore random measurements that are higher than the points that you're looking? Let's take the true average. Points that are higher will be registered. Points that are lower will stop at zero.
Right.
There must be somebody who's done a statistical analysis and corrected for this. Has anyone tried it on this data?
If when you get close to zero, you probably should be using a Poisson distribution rather than a...
Either that, or there's a variety of ways of doing that, and I just wondered if you ran across anybody who'd done it.
I don't think that most people have gotten that sophisticated in their statistics. I did once because there was a value where it actually gave a number less than zero. And of course, that's impossible. Boykin's 1993. And I can give you the reference if you're interested. The way it got less than zero was actually They took some methane from natural gas, and they got a date for it. And then they took some methane that had been de-enriched in carbon-13, and therefore super de-enriched in carbon-14, so that it should have, by standard projections, have had less than 1/2000th of the carbon-14 that it had to begin with. And it dated, the first one dated 0.56%, pardon me, 0.056% modern carbon. And the second one dated 0.057% modern carbon, which of course shouldn't be possible. And if you do a little bit of sophisticated dating and you say, what is the upper limit of that? It turns out to be 0.0003 or something like that, percent modern carbon. It's in the review that I did in 2001, the upper limit of, you know, obviously goes all the way to zero. Interestingly, when they actually put that material into the Borax-Sino reactor, they found out that it had four times as much carbon-14 as the theoretical upper limit of normal. So apparently, we weren't being generous enough allowing how much carbon-14 there was in that very old and isotope-skewed methane from natural gas.
I guess my second question is, if there was a great deal more carbon in the carbon cycle prior to the flood, how much more would it take to get, I don't know, your median value down to truly representing something like 4,000 years?
It's actually pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've never seen it done, but...
The Septuagint date for the flood is 5,500 BC, or pardon me, 5,500 before present. And that's pretty close to 5,730 years, which is the actual half-life of carbon-14. So it's about a half-life ago. Maybe 55%, maybe, you know, something right in there. If you're doing it for the standard Masoretic text, it's more like about 60% of what we have now. So you drop roughly half just from the time. Now, then from there, it's a straightforward percent modern carbon. That is to say, if you have actually 1% at that point, so you calculate back to that point and then you just see what it would have been then. If you have 1% modern carbon, that means you have to have 100 times the amount of regular carbon to dilute that carbon-14 out that far. It's just you take one over the number, and that's your amount of regular carbon projected in the ancient biosphere.
Is that realistic?
There are estimates that range from about 1 to 100 to 1 to 500 amount of carbon that we have in the biosphere to what's underground in coal and oil.
No, I understand that, but my question is, can you get all that into the carbon cycle realistically at one time?
Supposing that you had more land mass than you have now, supposing that all of the deserts were productive and they were all comparable to what we have in rainforest now, you're probably looking at about maybe 50 times more or less of the carbon that we have now. And that's in the land.
It'd be difficult to walk around, though.
Maybe we were intended to live in forests. Yes.
I've had some discussions with Bob Brown about that issue in the past, and need to keep in mind it may not be just a factor of dilution that produced those older dates. It may be there just wasn't that much carbon-14 in the atmosphere. For one thing, I would say, a major flood, which has changed the biota significantly and at least produced the changes we proposed during that flood, would be expected to probably leave some kind of imprint here of some kind. Complicating the picture, of course, is the fact that the present rate of carbon-14 production does not permit us to reach the level of carbon-14 we have now in 6,000 years. You can, of course, you know, Bob Brown was very much convinced that the Earth was here before creation week as an empty sphere and so on. I tend to agree with him on that. It could be that the carbon-14 was less here and that when the waters below and above, and I don't have good models in that area at all, were separated and so on, carbon-14 was not part of the mixture at this time, and it was at a lower level. It's just a suggested model here. And it came down at the time of the flood, and that's why we have a higher level at present. Just speculations, but it's ideas to consider.
Well, there are a couple of other things. One of them is that carbon-14 could have been made in the stratosphere and taken considerably more time to come down here if you don't have as much vertical mixing as you did as you do at present. The other thing is that if there's a stronger magnetic field, not as much carbon-14 would be made because more of the solar wind would be diverted out somewhere else, and you would not get as many collisions with cosmic rays and in the upper atmosphere. It's not a major, but if you had 100 times as much of a magnetic field, you would have approximately 1/16 of the production that we have now. So it would be a factor that you'd have to work in. The truth of the matter is, if I was looking for a difficulty here, actually, the biggest one that I would have is, can you get all of that stuff into a biosphere big enough to produce the coal deposits that we have now? And you're off by about an order of magnitude, well, by about double to triple, depending on whose estimates you're listening to. It's possible that we're actually looking at a biosphere that had collected considerable dead components on the ground before the flood ever happened. That'd be one way of trying to account for that. In which case, if they died earlier, you might be able to see some of those deposits giving you older ages than other deposits simply because the later ones had more exposure to carbon-14. We have a comment over here. Just a minute. We're getting your mic so we can record this.
The comment in back of me here is an interesting comment, but is there an on and off?
There you go. Just hold it up close enough.
The fact is that if one takes seriously the published uncertainties, one can get negative numbers, plus or minus. If the value is, for example, sufficiently small, the minus, plus, and minus can encompass a negative number.
That's true.
So if one takes seriously the published numbers, the measured numbers, then I don't see it relevant to suggest that this might be an explanation why this should be difficult to accept. My concern is primarily you have spent your time on anecdotal data. Anecdotal evidence. C14, you haven't spent any time on positive numbers, positive evidence, and nor have you spent any time on, maybe you do this other places, other times, but the weight of evidence from many other radiometric methods for the age of life, not merely dinosaurs, especially dinosaurs, because you've emphasized dinosaur carbon, but other forms of life, the This presentation reminds me of what, in my opinion, is wrong about Adventist science. We tend to ignore the weight of evidence and hone in on some little mystery somewhere. Bob Gentry's book, The Creation's Little Mystery, is an example. And ignore the vast weight of evidence. And I think that only if we face up to the weight of evidence in an intelligent way among people who can understand that sort of thing, will we in fact make progress, real progress, in our understanding within the church of what the evidence really is. Until we do that, I think we'll be simply moving in circles as we have for decades without making real progress.
Well, perhaps I can ask you if you personally know of some data that is being ignored that should be looked at in terms of carbon-14. I will agree with you that I think that we need to deal with the rest of radiometric dating. And if you'll notice in one of the things that I listed, that's one of the things we should be talking about. And eventually, we will get to some of that.
I would leave up to the expert in dating those questions and answers. Taylor, for example, it would be a good place to start. Are you familiar with G. Brent Dalrymple's work?
Yes, I am.
100-page monograph that he has published.
Yes, I've read
specifically
it
completely directed toward
through.
Creationists.
I have, yes.
You know, Dalrymple was considered by many to be the dean of radiometric dating, director of Geological Survey, U.S. Geological Survey, for many years before he moved to Oregon. He spent a lot of his time, personal time, talking specifically, trying to get creationists to look at the evidence, all of the evidence. Here was a man, not an Adventist, trying to get some of us to be more open. And I think we could do worse than following up and studying those monographs. Bring those monographs into the classroom, into this room, having our people, if we're really serious about understanding, studying those things, the weight of evidence, rather than getting bogged down. And I do really think that's a good description in anecdotal evidence.
Well, I would say this. If you don't personally know of anything, if you will notice the critics that I quoted, number one, those are not in the peer-reviewed literature. You can't find a response in the peer-reviewed literature. Now, hopefully, when Irv Taylor makes his comments, they will be in the peer-reviewed literature, in which case I'll be very interested in hearing what he has to say. So far, he hasn't chosen to reveal to me all that he's decided to say, so it's difficult to respond to something that you don't know. But I want to point out something to you that I think is important. I think that if you're going to be honest, not only do you have to deal with all of the other radiometric dating, but I think you also have to deal with this particular part of carbon-14. And I think that it is the honest thing to say now that the data looks like there is some carbon-14 in some of that material, and how much of that material remains to be seen, and that it should be an active area of research. And who knows? It may turn out to be that it actually does argue for a straight age for life on Earth. I don't think we should arbitrarily exclude that as a possibility.
I don't disagree with that. But I would like to have someone agree with me, or at least not disagree with me, when I say open it up to complete looking at the complete picture rather than a tiny part of the picture. Mm-hmm. The anecdotal evidence you suggested, I think, would be interesting projects. I can think of myself, perhaps, as an Adventist scientist, getting bogged down in a few weeks of my time to look into the neutron flux that might be produced, neutron cross-sections, you know, do a study like that. It might be cute to do, fun to do, but I don't think that should prevent me from looking at the entire picture in drawing conclusions about when and how we came about and how things came about.
Yeah, I think this is another side to your comment, and I appreciate your concern. I think Adventists are much more open to studying various viewpoints than are secular scientists who will not allow for God in their model, for instance, and who try and answer everything on a materialistic mode, so they'll qualify as a scientist. There's a tremendous bias there. If we always go by the weight of evidence, folks, there's no chance for progress. You're going to say everybody that doesn't go by the weight of evidence is off the track. We're going to stay with the same paradigm. If you want progress, you got to be willing to break out of the circle. And I think that Adventists tend to break out of the circle more than regular scientists do. To repeat an example, there was an accreditation team here at Loma Linda and La Sierra, and they were informed that we teach creation here. Oh, this is a terrible thing, you know. Some of the members of the team came to the dean and I told him, hey, you are teaching creation here. And the dean told him, yes, we do. And we teach evolution. And our students here are far more informed on this area than the students at Berkeley, where they only teach evolution. I hope you get my point. And I think that one can say we're not, Adventist scientists are not as closed as has been suggested to looking at other data. And many of us are trying to be careful and honest and fair and look at the whole picture. But it's not just carbon-14 data. There's all kinds of other data that challenges the long ages, rates of erosion, and so on. The dating of human fossils and so on, this dinosaur dating, the tissues you find in dinosaurs and so on. I mean, Ellen White told us, you know, that all who want to hang their doubts will, I'm paraphrasing because I can't remember the exact words.
Hooks on which to hang your doubts will find them.
But those who want to believe will find plenty of evidence to support this. And having studied for some 50 years into this area, I can tell you there is plenty of evidence there if you want to look for it. And it's important that we look for it because many people are carried away by the science, and science is very successful in certain areas. Our data is wonderful. Their interpretations are subject to alternatives. And there we can make a contribution in providing some alternative interpretations that include the Bible, include the possibility of a God, and that solve a lot of these problems like the origin of life and the precision of the forces of physics and so on that demand a designer. That picture makes more sense to me than just going with what the scientific community happens to be following at present.
One thing I might comment, and that is that, in fact, I have worked with this kind of thing before. In a book that was published by La Sierra University, somewhat ironically, called Scientific Theology, I did a fairly comprehensive, at least covering all of the dating methods, review of, you know, what the dating methods were, what their advantages were, what their limitations were, and that since La Sierra University Press is now defunct, I put the book online, and you can get it at scientifictheology.com for free. And so if you're interested in what I do with Dalrymple's data, and I cite some of it, you can look there. So it's not like I haven't thought of this kind of thing before, or I haven't looked at it, that I've, you know, closed my eyes to all of that kind of stuff and am just pushing something. What I'm trying to say today is not that all radiometric dating points towards short age. What I'm trying to say is there are certain significant findings out there, some of which reach beyond what you would usually call anecdote. When you're doing 10 coals from different eras, that's starting to be a study rather than an anecdote. When you're doing dinosaur bones from all over the place from different eras, that's starting to be a study rather than an anecdote. The things that the dates that Andrew Snelling published at the very beginning were in fact anecdotal evidence. They were exactly the kind of thing that I think you have to be careful about, because they're one date on one sample that was dated along with dates on other samples. And although if you keep doing that, after a while you begin to wonder about it, I think when you start, you know, pulling 10 dates from here and 10 dates from there, now you're starting to talk about more of a massive evidence than just simply anecdote. And I think that while young budding Adventists may not necessarily want to decide that they want to go that route, that they should be exposed to the evidence. And that's part of what I'm trying to do here.
Paul, yeah, may I just add to my comments that we need to keep in mind this tremendous bias there is in the scientific literature, and that it accepts only materialistic interpretations at present. And we know from those interpretations that the model does not work, like the origin of life. We have 500,000 scientists, that's probably a very conservative figure, and who will only publish within a materialistic model. We have only a handful who are willing to include God in the Bible in the picture. And so going by the weight of evidence, keep in mind that the only evidence that's allowed to be printed does not ask the question, what is truth? It asks, what is the materialistic interpretation?
Well, actually, many of those people don't know that there's a difference between those two.
Well, naturally, you can do a lot of science without invoking God or the Bible or this type of thing. We need to keep that in mind. But when it gets to questions of cosmology and so on, God tends to be ignored in science textbooks and in science journals.
I have a question from a laywoman. A friend comes to me and said, how can you believe in creation? Don't you know that carbon-14 dating says that the beasts that are found are thousands and thousands of years older than that? What do I, as a layperson, say?
Well, it's a fair question. Actually, the people that say that will usually say millions of years older than that. And I'll just point out two things. Number one is that you're dealing with what is essentially a bipolar situation. That is to say, things cluster around usually 6,000 to 8,000 years, or things cluster around, in these cases, 65 million, 100 million, 300 million, whatever. That there is very little middle ground. Nobody is claiming that they're really about 3 million years old, or let's say 500,000 years old. There's the two models that are out there pretty much suck everybody into one or the other. So it's a question of thousands, not millions, rather than a question of the exact amount. The second thing is that this we're just discussing carbon-14 right now, and there are other things that you need to be aware of later, and that's one of the reasons we're going to go over some of them. But if you're talking about carbon-14 dating itself, the data we have looks like it argues for in the range of 40,000 radiocarbon years. That is not really compatible with, say, 100 million years. It's just not. In fact, it's not compatible with a million years. And the reason for that is that if you took the entire world and made it out of nothing but carbon-14, and this is, you can do this at home, that all of it would decay to nitrogen-14 except for one atom in a million years. And that atom itself would have a greater than 99% chance of decaying. Now, technically, there could be two atoms because of the chances, but, you know, the numbers there start to get astronomically small. So basically, if you have million-year-old stuff, it should have no measurable carbon-14 in it whatsoever, period. And that's why the people who are doing this are at such pains to try to find some other cause for the carbon-14. Because if you can't, it destroys the standard timescale. Now, what do you do if you're a creationist? You'll notice that one of those quotes said, well, that's not young enough for creation. But let's supposing that the biosphere, let's supposing you're trying to explain something that's 1% modern carbon, which is less than the dinosaurs but greater than the coal. A simple note that 99% of the biosphere that we have now, or pardon me, of the biosphere that was at one time, is underground, means that we have less carbon to dilute the carbon-14 out. And as a kind of a rough first approximation, that means that you can have that carbon be as recent as you want. There are calculations that can be done, and if you're going to run into this again and again, it might be worth your while to familiarize yourself with them. but those calculations suggest that, in fact, with the biosphere that we have, we're looking at less than 20,000. And there's no particular reason why it couldn't be 4,300, although, you know, 5,000. With this data, you can't distinguish between Masoretic Septuagint or somebody's 10,000-year account. But what you can say is it's probably not even 40,000. It's more like, you know, more like 20,000 or less. So creationists are very comfortable with this data. Evolutionists are not.
Clearly, we're all about a search for truth. And we're limited, whether you believe in evolution or creation, our minds are limited. Sometimes the search for truth gets caught up in orthodoxy versus politics, whether that be science, whether it be religion. We as a church sometimes don't like, quote, free thinking. But I think God gave us a mind to think freely. And I use this little example totally out of the realm. when I attended the University of Washington, my major professor was quite an old man at the time, and he was leading the charge on the campus for free smoking pot. So they fired him from Washington, University of Washington. If he were there now, he'd fit right in. So,
that's,
you know, we have to be careful when we talk about who's Orthodox and who isn't. I believe the church has to be a large umbrella. And I think we have to search for what is truth. As a non-organic chemist, it goes beyond me, the study of carbon-14, even though I've studied a little bit of it. When I was in Ariel's class many, many years ago in the philosophy of science, I don't recall we ever studied continental drift, because that wasn't a concept that people were even looking at that point. And the evidence is clear now as to time frame and other things. So we have to take the issues that are, quote, hot. And as I watched the debate on television between creation and evolution, I couldn't accept either one as having total truth, because I thought the presentations, the creationist presentation was much better, in my view, not just because I believe in what he was saying, because I disagree with him on, you know, when the stars were created as a prime example. But I thought that the other side was not presented from a scientific point of view for debate. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to recognize we can disagree within our own orthodoxy without criticizing each other's intentions.
And I agree with that. And I might say that it sounds like your specialty is not carbon-14 dating, and so you wouldn't be prepared to do a detailed defense. But we have had Herb Taylor here before, and we've had dueling presentations. I won't say that I'm totally open and that there's, but I'm trying to be as reasonable as I can in that situation. We have had two people who, well, I would say probably don't lean toward short age, one of whom is distinctively long age, who have presented here on ice cores. Irv Taylor has presented on amino acid dating. So we do have a certain amount of openness in this area. And if you have something that you have that's particularly, you know, along your line, see me after class. We'll discuss the possibility of your being able to present it. Just a minute. Can we get a mic for him here?
I'll respond to that.
Here, just.
I think you can hear me without.
Well, we want other people to hear you too.
Oh, that's very good. We come up here with a frequency equal to about once every 5 years. So 5 years from now, I'll let you know when we come up here.
Okay.
My wife.
We plan long term, as you can see. So, yes.
But I will take this microphone opportunity to say, as an Adventist scientist, I have not found scientists and science in general to be biased, nor have I seen evidence for conspiracy within the scientific enterprise and publishing domain. That's my experience.
And for the most part, I am going to agree with you. I am given a little pause when the paleo group has their presentation retracted. I would have preferred to have it just left there, whatever, and then they don't want to publish the data, that's okay. But, you know, that starts to almost look like we don't like the data, so we won't even allow it to be.
Did you ask the authors why it wasn't there?
I published the only response that I have. And I have talked to those authors.
What was their response?
Well, their response was that it was just simply made to disappear, and the authors were not told that it disappeared that way. And you can still see it up now. So, yes, well, in most cases, I agree with you. I think there are some areas where some people do get a little sensitive and do pull things that really shouldn't be pulled. And it looks bad. I mean, you're looking at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. What happened to 5? It's the natural question. So it actually, in a way, it's counterproductive. If they just left it in, they'd probably get less notice. Of course, that's an anecdote, so...
That's exactly my comment. That's among the hundreds of thousands of publications, that would be an anecdote.
Yes.
It's interesting to me watching our institutions and so forth. There's a time period, it looks like to me, in which our science faculty have been trained. And I'm watching the same thing, as you mentioned, with smoking pot happen. I'm watching the same thing societally with my children regarding homosexuality. If you hit the same theme over and over again in the media, you can influence people where it now becomes, my gracious, you're a horrible person if you don't happen to believe homosexuality is okay, or why would you ever think that pot wasn't good? And you keep hitting this. I'm watching the same sort of thing to me happen when Dawkins calls his group the Brights, and they march around like a... saying how bright they are and that the other people aren't that disagree with them reminds me a little bit about kindergarten males walking around saying boys are better than girls kind of thing. If you hit the same media thing over and over again, I keep seeing this influence so that they come back and do what you just did, which is to say, well, we're not open to other points of view. Well, that doesn't, that blanket approach to anybody that's a creationist is not open to other points of view, I think is a little bit of influence by this media hit saying that same thing over and over again, that someone that doesn't agree with us, that doesn't believe in evolution, isn't open to other data. And I don't think that's a fair comment. There's just plenty of data to argue on both sides of the issue. And a true scientist would look at, try and look at every one of them and evaluate them as carefully as they can to come to a conclusion. It's amazing that we can take panspermia and somehow that's okay on pure speculation, or we can take multiple universes and that's okay on pure speculation. And yet, if we find something like carbon-14 dating, which if you really have carbon-14 there, you can't come up with another way to say that that stuff there. If you're going to pass it all off as contamination or uranium, okay, if you've got data for that, you can give that as an explanation. But it depends on your I think we get programmed by the media and by repetition to a whole lot of things that we don't recognize we're programmed to, and then fail to look at things objectively. And as a scientist, you need to try and overcome those and look at them objectively, either side of the issue you're on.
Now, in all fairness, some of the people who are creationist do kind of go, the Bible says it and I believe it and that settles it. I think that's one of the things that came out of the Ken Ham and I debate, which I think could have been handled much differently and better on Ken Ham's part.
But I will allow Kim Ham to do that, as well as I will allow the atheist to say it has to be evolution, there can't be a God, therefore I look at things from that point of view. I will allow them to have that point of view as long as it's up front and I understand that's what their bias is, and therefore they will interpret the data that way. The other group will interpret. I hopefully will pick a line in which I'll try and objectively look at both sides of it to make a conclusion. But you're not going to eliminate all those biases. The problem is we often don't understand the ones we're operating under.
I think I'd agree with you on that. We have a comment over here. What's the closest mic? Hello.
I come here more often than every 5 years, so I maybe can make a comment. I live in Washington, D.C., well, the suburbs thereof, and I worked in government grants for some time, and I was never had any doubt that if I said certain things, it was the end of the grant. Washington's a political city, yet they dole out lots of money to the scientific community. And if you believe that they believe in academic freedom, I'm afraid you haven't lived in Washington, D.C. And can I use this little simple example? I grew up in a Christian home, and my father taught religion. And I'm sure I came home as a child and said, I've been taught that the stars were created on the fourth day, because I've seen some of the pictures I drew. When I got older in academy, my teacher says, I've got the answer. When God created the stars, he created the light beam at the same time. So it's all according to our interpretation. I took a class in the university, and my teacher, the Bible teacher, said, that's wrong. The Old Testament doesn't teach that. That's a misinterpretation. And so I went home to my dad and said, you really need to fire that guy. He's not orthodox. And my father laughed, and he said, he's right. I said, well, why didn't you tell me that years ago? He said, well, you didn't ask me that years ago. and so sometimes we battle our best friends more than we do our enemies. And I think there's enough evidence against the theory of the beginning of life to just have happened that I can argue that issue very easily. Some of these issues that we're debating are a little harder to defend. And I'm sure, because I believe in a heaven, that if I'm allowed to be there, that I'll get straightened out on a lot of these issues.
I would just second that and say that you know, the geological community tends to ridicule creationists. They're fair at times and so on. I've given a couple lectures at UCR in their geology department, one on why I believed in God, and another one on why I believed in the flood. So that second one was under the aegis, I think they both were, that the students wanted to hear the other side of the story, because they'd been hearing only one side in their classrooms. But I would just say, from my personal experience, you get out there in that geological record, there are a lot of questions. There's no question, you can raise some. But there's data out there that is very hard to explain unless you believe in a short chronology. I'd say two of the major things you need to keep in mind is the extreme widespread nature of very thin layers out there. I'm talking about 100,000 square miles of a layer only 100 feet thick of the Chernarp conglomerate. I'm talking about 815 square kilometers, well, let's say 400,000 square miles of the Dakota Formation. That's only maybe 100 feet thick and spread over, 315,000 square miles, to be accurate. Try and lay a layer on the surface of the Earth, now on the continents, that size, that thin. You're not going to be able to do it. Our topography is so different. It's so different.
Even try to lay it on the ocean at this point.
Yes, but these are not oceanic deposits here. We're talking about continental deposits here, right? So on. And then you look at my favorite topic, those gaps between the layers, and the little erosion that you find there compared to, it should be all gone, and rates of erosion in the continent should be all gone. Folks, we're not battling data as much as we're battling attitudes in this battle here. We need to keep this in mind, that these are major paradigms, and there's good data that says, you know, well, the standard paradigm can be challenged. But when you've got such an overwhelming number of scientists interpreting the data on one side, and they are allowed only to interpret it on that one side in the literature, there's a tremendous bias out there that you have to face. But don't go by the weight of evidence in the scientific literature. Go by the weight of the data, not the interpretations. There's a vast difference between those two.
I think there's one thing that I would say, and that is that, you know, if an Adventist kid grows up, or a Christian kid of any kind, and decides that they want to go for long age, decides that they want to be an atheist, for that matter, if they have looked at everything, I mean, God gives us the freedom to do that. And that I think that we should allow that, and we should not try to punish it. But I do think that it is fair to say that there are some subjects that any Adventist kid that goes through an Adventist school should see, especially an Adventist kid that is trying to be a scientist. And I think they should at least be aware of the data that we have on carbon-14 dating. Even if they decide later on that they don't like the interpretation that their teachers give to it, I think that to not give them the data itself is not right. And that's part of the reason why we're trying to do this series now. They really ought to at least hear about it. I'm going to let one last comment, and then...
I'm sorry. My postdoc mentor was, as far as I'm aware, essentially atheist. Yet I felt more of a kindred spirit with him. I felt more of... A sense of a kindred spirit with him, even though he was atheist, than I did with some of the people who are Christian. Now, how's that possible? Because he had a very high sense of scientific integrity, and he was atheist because he really didn't believe in God, but he wasn't atheist because the faith in God to him was somehow offensive. See, that's a big difference. And I wouldn't be surprised one bit if in the new earth we found ourselves, God willing, next to a bunch of atheists who are not so atheist anymore. And perhaps some of us will be better Christians in the process as well.
Well, next week we're going to talk about uranium lead dating. And so that's one of your dating methods that you think we should be looking at.
I'm not a radiometric dating expert. I'm a nuclear chemist. That means nuclear physics by the back door. So, you know, I can talk about all of these in my home, in my office, with pencil and paper, but I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge of the dates, nor have I done any laboratory work. I don't do that kind of work. But I think I understand. I think I can understand it down to the most detailed mathematics. I've taught nuclear chemistry and nuclear physics for all my life. So I have handouts on these subjects. So I feel quite comfortable. Not in giving you dates and the numbers you were giving. You know, this is, I didn't know about these things. But it does strike me that how many How many tens of thousands of C-14 beams are there in the literature? Do you have a rough number?
Actually, let's pass it on back to him. I'll tell you, I did a review that captured, I would estimate, somewhere upwards of 90% of the dates that were done on theoretically carbon-14 dead material, and reviewed them and have listed them in terms of the date that was gotten, where there was, where you'd have to read it off a graph. I'll note that I'm reading it off of the graph, and I'll give you the reference. And that is available on the publication Carbon-14 in Fossil Carbon, which can be found if you do an internet search, or if you look at the slide that I had up there that actually has the data, so you can go back and look at it. And that's pretty close to encyclopedic for the time that it was printed.
There must be tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of such dates.
No, actually, most of the time they don't publish those dates. That's usually published because they're using it as demonstration of the background of their machines. It's not usually published as we did a whole bunch of coal and this is what we got. Because most scientists who come at it from a long age perspective don't find that to be interesting material. And if they publish that it has a low carbon-14 date, it actually, and they start finding carbon-14 in it, if they find more than a certain amount, it starts reflecting badly on their laboratory, because, you know, you should be able to get zero, and you're getting 0.5% or 1% of your... Well, you need to tighten up your procedures a little bit. So that's a problem with that particular thing. There aren't that many dates out there, and I have done a pretty good job of surveying the literature on it. I won't say it's 100%. In fact, after I published it, I found one laboratory that had escaped my my review, which actually made the point even more strongly. But I do know that I made an effort to include everything that there was and came pretty close.
I think that what Dr. Van Ys is asking for, and what I would like to see too, is the fact that there are many, many, probably 10,000 or 100,000 carbon-14 dates on sequences like the Irish Oaks
right.
that go back through this whole time period.
Right.
And that data, it seems to me, is very relevant. I agree with you that most of the dates that you're picking from are ones that were done for background. So
you're looking at finite dates there.
Yeah.
Whereas we're talking about
supposedly
infinite dates.
Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah.
But since they cover the same time period and those dates will go back in essentially unbroken sequences to, 18,000 or 20,000 years, then the knee-jerk reaction to having these two series of dates would be to say, we've got an anomaly here. The anomaly is partially explained by contamination. There is something that isn't explained by contamination. But given that we have other continuous series that go through this time period, let's continue looking to see if there is some additional explanation, and not jump immediately to the fact that this invalidates carbon-14. Now, I may be putting words in his mouth, but my guess is that he's thinking along something along those lines, because the easiest way to explain this would be to say, we don't understand the little bit that's left over. Probably it's an anomaly. Let's go look to see if it is, rather than reading into it invalidation of the entire carbon-14. Mm-hmm. dating system, but I'll give the microphone to him and let him.
Yeah, very well stated, I think. My point is that unusual claims require unusual evidence. And I think it's the case that this would be an interest. I think it should be on the part of the creationists. I think the geoscience people probably should take these 100, 200, dozens, whatever there are, I put them in the category of anecdotes, anecdotal data. The words we attach to these numbers is really immaterial. The fact is, I think they're probably a small fraction of the total. I could be wrong, but I have a feeling they may very well be a small fraction. And the creationists should take this as a research project, a challenge to demonstrate that, in fact, there is no way that you can explain these finite numbers on old life material except in some unusual way. I think it should be taken as a challenge. I don't have a lot, personally, it's not an interest of mine. I don't find this very interesting, but I think Roth and his colleagues should take this as a challenge to solve the mystery.
Well, I will say this much, and because I'm personally involved in this kind of thing, that when I did my literature review, I went down to the Institute for Creation Research, which was at the time doing this radiometric dating project that they've now published, and I said to them, you know, we have all this data. We really should do a study, an actual formal study, rather than just picking pieces out here and there. And that's when they did those 10 cold dates. And you can read about all the details of, you know, what they did and how they did it. And so they were doing exactly what you were proposing. Now, do I think we should stop there? No. I'd like to see more of this same kind of research. But I will say that what you've suggested should be done has at least been started. And for me, I say more power to them. Obviously, I did more than say that. I went down and persuaded them to do it.
Gentlemen, yeah, Dr. Van Nuys? Yes. Well, we commoners coming here, we want to strengthen our faith and to feel that this could be nothing but anecdotal kind of hits us hard. You know, so you have not left the church, so there has to be something for faith to connect us together as being under a big umbrella. I like that, you see. So being a nuclear physicist and still calling, being a Seventh-day Adventist, I 5 years, who knows what's going to happen. Perhaps in a short time, our Christian brother could explain, you know, from his point of view, what it means. I mean, it's a short age, long age, from the point of view of nuclear scientist. Is that possible?
Is what possible?
Yeah, to explain what, from your point of view, nuclear science talks about. Mm-hmm.
Impinges on the age of the Earth.
Yeah, I gave, well, a number of years ago, I gave a series of seminars, series of lectures on the subject of the age of the Earth and life. I advertised it to the faculty where I teach, and there was some interest, and I had maybe a dozen people would attend. I would say, I don't remember how many lectures I gave anymore, but yeah, I've done that, yeah. It can be done. And you've got a nice, you've got a forum for it here. Of course, you got an entire Sabbath school with the title of Faith and Science, I think. This would be an ideal place to do it, this place here.
Well, as they say in some parts, come on down.
No, but what's the one sentence you could put together that says, from studying all this, this is what I conclude? Is that possible?
No.
No, the problem, as he pointed out, it would be a several part lecture probably. I mean, this and carbon 14, I've whittled away a whole bunch of material that could have been there. We could have taken 4 or 5 hours on carbon 14 alone, and that doesn't count a whole bunch of other radiometric dating techniques that there are there, along with amino acid dating, which would require its own half hour or more. So there's a lot of data. What we're going to try to do is we're going to try to look at pieces of it, realizing that they aren't the whole, but trying to make as much sense of them as we can.
Important to my model is bringing in experts in the field. You've made a presentation. In my model, I would maybe alternate. I would have Taylor come in, certainly, have him address these things. It may very well be that there are some fairly good answers. I don't know. Then I would have you present another one, someone else present, and then bring in an expert in the field. You live in an intellectual paradise down here. Southern California, you've got experts in all the universities. I wouldn't be surprised if it would be quite easy to get someone, a young assistant professor in the appropriate field, to come in and talk about and summarize some of the evidence in areas that you would like to include in this logically thought out a series of lectures to bring the people up to speed. I do gather from the, and I hesitate to make this comment, but I do gather that I know from my own experience, we tend to present lectures like this to a relatively scientifically unsophisticated audience. And that's one of the problems we have. You can get by with murder, pretty much, in the lecture. You can get by with murder by presenting to an audience that doesn't know much about radiometric dating and doesn't know much about C14 dating, let alone radiometric dating in general. So that's one of the problems we have. We come in making progress toward real understanding.
Well, I will tell you that although I'm quite aware that that not everybody here is even up to my level in terms of carbon 14 dating, there are people outside who are looking at this because it's going on the internet, and every once in a while we get feedback on some aspects of it. So although that doesn't mean that we do it perfectly, it does mean that we try to be a little bit more careful about what we say in terms of making conclusions. You know, one of the things you will not hear me say is that, see, I have this presentation and therefore everybody who doesn't believe in short age is an idiot, because I don't think that that's either true or fair.
Is this presentation and the discussion going on the internet?
Yes.
Good. Where will we look for it?
Do you have a? Just go. I can get you another one of those folders and.
Just go to your web page.
Yeah. Do you have that? And then we'll just give it to him, and he can have it.
Yeah. My last comment would be: I once spent a day with a chemist from Sweden. He came to Washington, and through some friends we got together. And in the he happened to be a Nobel Prize winner, but that wasn't the reason we got together. In the first 5-10 minutes we talked about what we believed and what we didn't, and it was totally different. And then we spent the rest of the day enjoying each other's company. and he gave my wife a bottle of wine when we were finished. But my point simply is this, that sometimes we make more enemies when we argue with them than when we find out what they believe and we tell them what we... I told him what I believed. I was a creationist. I believed in God. And, you know, he asked me a few questions. I asked him what he believed, and he really didn't... You know, that wasn't his issue. He was a organic chemist who happened to be a Nobel Prize winner. And the rest of the day, we had a great day together because we shared a common interest. Better to emphasize the common interest. There is a place and a time to defend our faith and do it strongly, but I think it's the method we use sometimes. But I wouldn't say it's just creationists have that problem. Oh, I see a lot of evolutionists with that problem.
That is true.
That's very important. God is trying relentlessly to save every person. Let's do all we can to help him and put that as a priority instead of our personal viewpoints.
Well, next week I welcome you to uranium lead dating, and as we have time and as we have experts, I hope that the plan is at least for Leonard Brand to talk about the Kokanee and Sandstone, since he's a kind of a somewhat of an authority on that, and when he has the time, why we'll have him present. And if I imagine that eventually we'll have Ariel Roth talk about paraconformities and soft sediment deformation and a few things like that, and we'll try to cover these subjects as carefully and honestly as we can. And for those of you who can, see you next week. For those of you who can, see you in 5 years or whenever.